which we did in the last topic. Hope you remember devaluation, revaluation. These are the regulation of forex market by RBI, government securities market, etc. Okay. So these are repetitive, but the purpose of telling you all this is these roles are interrelated. Okay. These roles, somewhere or the other, hinting towards the regulation of monetary policy or money supply. So can you see, money supply is mainly contributed by banks or NBFCs. So it makes sense that RBI regulates it. Similarly, money market instruments like call borrowings. Even forex market can impact money supply. You recall, devaluation can increase money supply. Okay, government securities market can impact money supply. So it makes perfect sense that all these regulations are under the hands of RBI. Okay, they are interrelated. Okay, let's find up with some more important functions. Like fourth and fifth are very similar. RBI also act as a banker to banks and banker to government, both central government and state governments. What do we mean by this? Banker to bank and banker to government. It simply means that they can give loans to them, they can accept deposits from them. Okay, so RBI can give loans to the banks, repo market, loans to the government, not reference repo, that is ways and means advances. Okay, the government one. But more importantly, they accept government deposits. RBI keeps the deposits of the government, even of the bank. So that is why what we mean by banker to the banks and government. So the function which banks are performing for us, RBI performs for the banks. Okay. And one last role with which I wind up here. RBI is also regulator of payments and settlement system. Okay, I have already discussed this, the payments and settlement system, the modes of payment and settlement, that also is regulated by RBI. In fact, this is being debated a lot right now, if you are following newspapers. Government is trying to set up another body for regulating the payment and settlement system, which is sort of opposed by RBI. I would say RBI is correct, okay, because payment and settlement system is again having direct implication on monetary policy. So ideally, payment and settlement system should be hand off the same institution which is taking up the monetary policy. Okay, because the rules and regulations related to these checks or demand drafts or mobile wallets do have serious impact on the money supply in the economy. Now let's see what comes out of that debate. But fortunately, till this time, payment and settlement system is under RBI only. Okay, so this was just to give you the various roles of RBI. But keep in mind, major role is the first one. In fact, all the other roles which we also talk about, directly or indirectly, making the RBI the regulator of the money supply, the monetary policy. Okay. So we now devote a section on exclusively on the monetary policy, where we will discuss the different instruments which RBI goes for, okay, using in order to change the money supply. And just one more thing before the instrument. You should also keeping at the back of your mind the objectives of monetary policy. What exactly RBI is trying to achieve through the regulation of the monetary policy? There are two major objectives. One, price stability or keeping inflation under control. Okay, price stability is same as keeping inflation under control. And the second one, to provide adequate credit productive economic sectors. Why is the second one important? Because unless we provide adequate credit to the productive economic sectors, we cannot have GDP growth. We cannot have investment. Okay, so credit is very important. Okay, you have seen that already through an example in the last class. Without credit, money supply cannot be created. Without money supply, GDP cannot grow. Okay, because for GDP, we need financing parallelly. Okay, without credit, investment cannot go up. So both are very important. Price stability or keeping inflation lower and providing adequate credit, both are important. The problem is, sometimes they are conflicting. Okay, and this is not what we are doing for the first time in a way. I hope you recall, in the first topic when we were talking about expansionary or contractionary fiscal monetary policy, we had seen something which leads to higher GDP growth tends to increase inflation, and the other way around, inflation growth conflict. Okay, that inflation growth conflict bothers RBI many a times in its monetary policy. Because if RBI goes on controlling inflation, the price stability, it may lose its authority over the adequate credit, or GDP growth may be lower. When GDP growth is being focused upon through adequate credit, RBI may find it difficult to keep inflation low. All that you need to understand is RBI role is very difficult. Okay, how to maintain a balance between the two is really difficult, and that is why RBI has got many instruments of monetary policy. In fact, that is a common question which comes the moment I start the instruments of monetary policy. Why so many? As in, why can't RBI have just one or two monetary policy instruments? Because their role is difficult. Okay, so they need different instruments at different times in different magnitude to ensure the double aspects of monetary policy, maintaining price stability as well as providing adequate credit. Okay, so keep this at the back of your mind throughout the section, because this is the goal with which RBI is taking up the monetary policy instruments. However, as I told you that our major focus of the section will be to talk about these instruments and to look into their workings. So with every instrument, I'll particularly focus on two things. We define them, okay, although some of the definitions you are already aware of, you will realize that. After defining them, we look into their working. How do they impact money supply? Instruments of monetary policy itself can be of two types, at least in the beginning classification. Quantitative and qualitative. So monetary policy instruments can be classified into quantitative and qualitative instruments. We will focus more on quantitative. In fact, major part of this section is devoted to quantitative. Towards the end, we will talk of some qualitative. I won't give you the difference here, because unless you look into the instruments, the two types, it will be difficult to specify the difference. So we'll do the difference a little later. In the meantime, let's talk of some important quantitative instruments. The first one, cash reserves ratio, CRR. Okay, so we begin our discussion with a concept called CRR. Before I define CRR, let me refer once again to the concept of reserves. So in the last class, we were talking about the reserves of a bank. Okay, we go into a little more depth here. Reserves of a bank can be classified on various bases. Okay, here we are talking about two types of reserves. required reserves and excess reserves. So in this classification, reserves of a bank can be required or excess. Required means certain cash balances which the banks are statutorily required. Okay. To keep with RBI. In fact, the CRR concept is coming from here itself. I'll define CRR, but just hold on. Let me define first of all the excess reserves also and tell you how they are different from the first one. So required reserves mean those cash balances which are statutorily required for the banks to keep with RBI, to maintain with RBI. Apart from that, there may be a voluntary reserve. So excess reserves are voluntarily maintained. Okay. Excess reserves are up to the bank. They may keep it, they may not keep it. Most of them keep some of it. Okay. But why do they keep it voluntarily? Why are they voluntarily maintained? The question comes because reserves are like a loss for bank. That I have told you in the last class, that they cannot give that as a loan. Why would any bank voluntarily keep reserves? Because they need to manage their liquidity situation. So this voluntarily maintained reserves are for short-term liquidity management. And we are going to use this argument in later part of our section also. So I repeat, over and above the statutory requirement, banks can keep excess reserves voluntarily with the purpose of short-term liquidity management. Short-term liquidity management here means to manage the sudden deficit or surplus in liquidity. We have talked about it in the last class. Remember, call money market, when I discussed, I told you that banks can face unpredictable liquidity. Today, a bank may be having surplus money. Next week, they may be having deficit money. So how do they manage that surplus or deficit of liquidity? Okay, how do they even out the surplus and deficit of their liquidity? This is called short-term liquidity management. This is the main purpose of keeping excess reserves. Okay, in excess reserves, what do they keep in general? Mostly cash, mostly currency. Okay, so cash or currency which banks keep, I've told you that also, that there is a part of currency with banks also. This cash banks are keeping as excess reserves, mainly for short-term liquidity management. Okay, I hope I'm clear on this. But in this part, we have main focus on the required reserves. We are doing CRR definition now. CRR refers to the ratio of required reserves and NDTs, the net demand and time liabilities. Again, a concept which we did in the last class, NDTL. So, required reserves upon NDTL is called cash reserve ratio. Generally, we put it in percentage, for which you need to multiply that by 100. So, it's a very straightforward concept. CRR is telling us that out of the total net demand and time liabilities, how much is the cash balance which banks must maintain with RBI? Okay, this is a statutory requirement, they have no option, but they have to keep it with RBI. Okay, what is current CRR value? 4%. Okay, 4% CRR means that for every 100 rupees of their deposit or NDTF, 4 rupees have to go to RBI. Okay, this appears very small amount, but it's not that small. If you talk about the total NDPL, and banks hate this concept. Okay, if you talk to any banker, they are actually hating the CRR. Can you see why? There are two reasons. One, anyone can guess by the definition. Banks cannot give that part as a loan. Okay, they are legally supposed to keep it with RBI. They cannot give it as a loan. But the problem doesn't end there. On this CRR, on these cash balances, they are getting no interest, zero interest from RBI. Are you following that? So this is a complete loss for them. Okay, neither can they give this part as a loan, nor do they get any interest on that. Okay, even if RBI would have given interest, it would have been a relative loss for them. Because RBI will never give as much interest as we can give to the bank when we take the loan. But fine, here RBI is even more strict. It does not give any kind of an interest. So any bank would not like to keep CRR. In fact, there is a lot of debate which has gone into it, where banks have said that either reduce it further or at least give some interest on it. Okay, 4%, they consider it to be quite high still. Why then RBI keeps it? Because RBI claims that this is a very effective monetary policy instrument. And you will realize this gradually, even further, that why are we calling CRR as more effective? One of the most effective, rather. Okay, we'll talk about it once again. You can say that it is most effective only when you have something to compare with. We don't have anything to compare with right now. So we'll talk about why it is so effective a little later. How does it work? Let's talk about the working of CRR. Suppose RBI increases CRR. Okay. RBI goes for a higher CRR. The immediate impact of this will be reserve deposit ratio will go up. Okay, remember RDR. So higher the CRR, higher will be RDR. Goes without saying, because cash reserves are also a part of reserves. Required reserves and excess reserves, both are part of the total reserves. So the moment CRR is increased, and remember that is a statutory requirement, the reserve deposit ratio must go up. Can you see, there are no ifs and buts. It has to go up. You are already getting hint why this is so effective. RDR has to go up with higher CRR. When there is higher RDR, there is less loan supply to public. Okay, when reserve deposit ratio goes up, the loan supply gets reduced. You can word it in many other forms. You can say less loan supply to public from banks, obviously. Or you can say the bank's capability to give loan has reduced. Okay, so less loan supply to public or less capability to give loan. When there is less loan supply, the interest rate on loan goes up. So this will lead to higher interest rates on loans. Okay, loan supply is getting restricted. There is excess demand for loans in a way. So the interest rate is likely to move up. Higher interest rate means the loan has become costlier. Okay, public will take less loans, hence lower money supply. So when there is higher interest rate on loan, public will take less loans. Less loans will keep money supply lower. So higher CRR becomes a contractionary monetary policy. When RBI increases CRR, it is clearly a contractionary monetary policy. And vice versa for lower CRR. Okay, you can do that yourself. Lower CRR means RDR will go down. There is more loan supply to public. Lower interest rate, higher money supply. Now, I hope you followed this link properly. Because this link more or less will come in every monetary policy instrument. Okay, so I would be brief after this. Make sure you followed this link. Okay, through RDR to loan supply to public to interest rate to the final to finally the money supply in the economy. Okay, let's come to the second instrument. Okay, which is somewhere similar to CRR, but then there are many differences as well. Statutory liquidity ratio. SLR. Okay, in fact, fine, we'll talk about it once again. First of all, let's define what is SLR, the statutory liquidity ratio. SLR refers to the minimum proportion of NDPL which the banks are statutorily required to keep in terms of some specified liquid assets. So this is how we define SLR. And you will note the similarity with CRR. Just like CRR, this is also given as a minimum proportion of NDPL, which banks are statutorily required to maintain. Similarity continues. The difference is here. In SLR, it is not to be kept with RBI. It has to be with banks only in terms of some specified liquid assets. So it is in terms of some specified liquid assets. In terms of which specified liquid assets, there can be many of them. Let's talk of some examples. Government security, the most important. Okay. In fact, major part of SLR is often maintained in terms of the government security. Apart from that, we have excess reserves. Some SLR can be kept in the form of excess reserves. Some of them in the form of current account balance with other banks. Okay, current account balance you are aware of. So here we are talking of current account balance with other banks or assets like gold. There may be small part in terms of gold also in SLR. Okay, but as I told you already, the major SLR is in terms of government security. Okay, which makes logical sense also. Given a choice also, banks will typically keep major part of SLR in government securities because they generally give them good returns compared to the others. Government securities give them good returns, very safe security, you know that, gilt-edged securities. In fact, they can get other helps from here. Wait for some time, you will realize why keeping government securities are always helpful to the banks. So even given a choice, they will keep government securities as a major part of their SLR. SLR value right now is 19.5%. Okay, roughly around 20% you can say, which means roughly 1/5 of NDTL, 20% of NDTL approximately, a little less, is to be maintained in terms of these assets. This percentage is much higher compared to CRR. But then the good thing is that they are getting some returns. Okay, the banks are not in a complete loss. They are getting some returns on government securities. Banks don't even like SLR a lot. Okay, given a choice, they would not like to keep all this in government security, but they are not as bad for them as the CRR. Okay, how does SLR work as a monetary policy instrument? Let's see that. Okay, broader working is similar to CRR, but there are differences also. If RBI increases SLR, this can also possibly increase RDL. Now you will see the difference in the wordings which I am using. When I talked of CRR, I said higher CRR will increase RDL. Okay, now I am telling likely to increase RDL. Why the word likely to increase? Because RDL will go up only when the excess reserves increase. Okay, this is conditional upon increase in excess reserves. Remember, one part of SLR is excess reserves also. So when SLR is increased, banks can keep a little more in excess reserves. If they do, then RDR goes up, and the rest is the repetition of what we have done. Okay, in CRR, higher the RDR, lower will be the loan supply to public. Okay, less loan supply to public. Less loan supply to public will mean higher interest rates and lower money supply. Okay, so the pattern remains similar. Higher SLR is also likely to lower down money supply. MS here onwards for money supply. Okay, so higher interest rate will bring down the money supply. The same thing. Okay, we are repeating it. However, there are other things which are interesting over here. Okay, when SLR is increased, more common reaction by bank is they will buy more government securities. As I told you, they prefer government securities. So more government securities will be bought by banks. Now, can you see, this will also impact money supply in its own way. The moment government securities are bought, effectively the banks have given more loans to government. Government securities always mean government borrowings that you are aware of. So the moment we say that the bank is buying more government security, it implies there is more government borrowing. Now, don't you see, the moment government borrows more, there is again less loan supply for public. Okay, so there is another link. The moment government borrows more, there is less loan left for public. Loan amount is fixed somehow. If government decides to take more loan, and they will take if they decide, they have much better muscle power to take loan than the public. Okay, so if government take more loans, less will be left for public. Things get repeated. Higher interest rate, lower money supply. Okay, so higher SLR, still we are doing, is a contractionary policy. All that am I telling is that higher SLR can impact money supply in multiple forms. It can be through the mechanism of RDR. It can be through the mechanism of government borrowing. But the story is not complete yet. Okay, there is another interesting thing which is here. What will government do with these borrowings? They will spend mostly on welfare. Okay, the problem is that, not the problem, but the feature that you should understand is, if more government borrowings mean more welfare expenditure, okay, if using these borrowings they are spending more on welfare, I hope you are agreeing with me. A welfare expenditure, as in government will use the borrowing for, say, creating jobs, giving subsidies, whatever. Don't you think this will have a counteracting effect? This will increase money supply. Okay, whenever there is more welfare expenditure by the government, say on subsidies or wages or whatever, the money is moving away from government in the hands of public. So, which will have a counteractive effect of higher money supply. So, can you see there is a catch? In SLR, there are two counteracting forces working. Okay, although you should not be unnecessarily confused, we have seen that still higher SLR will lower money supply. This impact will be more powerful. Okay, the lower money supply impact will be more powerful, but you need to understand that some impact of higher SLR can also increase money supply. What I wanted to tell you was, definitely SLR is not as effective as CRR. Okay, now you will realize the importance of CRR even more. In CRR, there was a clear-cut indication that if it is increased, money supply has to go down. There is no doubt about it. It generally goes down in SLR also, but not as much, because there is a counteractive impact of higher money supply. So SLR is less effective monetary policy instrument than CRR. Okay, there is no doubt about it. SLR is less effective monetary policy instrument than the CRR. Because in CRR, there is no room left for banks. The moment CRR is increased, they have to keep more reserves with RBI. Here there is room, some space is there. They can put some of them in government security, some of them in excess reserve, some of them in gold. Okay, hence the SLR concept is not as effective monetary policy as CRR. But then SLR has got other roles also. SLR should never be looked at only as a monetary policy. It is a monetary policy, agreed. But can you see another thing? SLR is giving us an idea of the minimum guaranteed borrowings by government. What do I mean by minimum guaranteed government borrowings? Since SLR is also a statutory requirement, remember banks have to maintain it, and mostly they maintain it as government security, it becomes a minimum guaranteed government borrowings by the banks, from the banks, sorry. Minimum guaranteed government borrowings from the banks. Okay, in other words, even if government does not do anything, government can sit comfortably, around 19% of NDTL is coming as borrowed. Okay, they don't need to worry about it. Can you see that? Whatever is the SLR, roughly that much amount is a guaranteed borrowing coming to the government. Banks have to worry, not the government. So that is what banks don't like. Okay, banks say that if government needs loan, it should come to market. Okay, follow the market determined interest rate and borrow at that. Why should we be taking the tension of giving them guaranteed amount of loan? Okay, but somehow the SLR concept remains. Okay, so RBI keeps SLR, although it has decreased a lot. We'll talk about banking sector in pre-91 time period also, after some time, possibly in the coming class. There we will see that earlier SLR used to be even high. Now it has come down significantly. Okay, I hope I'm clear on SLR, their working, their definition, etc. Okay, let's come to the next monetary policy instrument. In fact, third and fourth instruments I do together. The third instrument that I discuss here is bank rate. And the fourth one is repo rate. Now the good thing is that I don't need to define them. We have done that in the last class. Okay, you know what is bank rate, what is repo rate. I straight away move to their working. Okay, and the reason why am I doing both of them together is their working is similar. Suppose that RBA goes for higher bank rate or repo rate. Okay, you can call it either, doesn't matter, the working is similar. If RBA goes for increasing the bank rate or repo rate, its first impact will be on excess reserves. It is likely to increase the excess reserves. Why so? If you understand this argument, you understood entire working. Because rest is a repetition. Okay, so make sure you understand this clearly. Why should higher repo rate, let's say, will increase excess reserves with banks? Because both are performing the same function for the bank. I told you a few minutes ago, excess reserves are used for short-term liquidity management. But then why is repo rate used? Same. Short-term liquidity management. Didn't we do in the last class that bank is taking a very short-term loan at repo rate, etc. Maybe for a month, maybe for a week, very short-term. And there also they have reverse repo where they can put the surplus. Fine, that flexibility is not in bank rate. But the basic idea here is to understand that excess reserves and the loan from repo market serve the same purpose, short-term liquidity management. I hope this is clear. Let's come to the second part. If the roles are similar, don't you think that when repo rate goes up, banks will argue that why should I take costlier loan from repo market? Rather than taking costlier loan from repo market or at bank rate, let's keep a little extra excess reserves. Okay, the bank will try to keep a little extra excess reserves because loans are becoming costlier. Fine, excess reserves is also not making profit for them, but then at least they are not paying interest on. Okay, repo rate is an interest rate that they have to pay to RBI. So, I repeat once again, a higher repo rate means costlier loan for the bank. If loan is costlier, they will try to keep a little extra excess reserve. Okay. No. Whatever is the demand deposit, keeping more excess reserves out of it. Okay, they don't have control over demand deposit. That we will decide. No, suppose repo rate keeps on going down significantly. Then they may say that why keep excess reserve? Let's keep more of the deposit in terms of loan. If I need money, I'll go to the repo market, take a loan. Isn't it? So that is the argument here. That repo rate is the interest rate on loan, short-term loan. If it is higher, loan is costlier. They will keep more of excess reserves. Don't think of deposit. Deposit is what bank cannot decide beyond the point. It's up to us. Okay, whether we want to keep deposit or not. Banks can decide that what part of that deposit should be kept in reserves and what part given as loans. Okay, that is up to the bank. Okay, now if this is clear, the rest is a repetition as I told you already. Higher the excess reserves, higher the RDR, the reserve deposit ratio goes up. Higher RDR, less loan supply to public. Less loan supply means higher interest rate and lower money supply. Okay, the interest rate on loan goes up, taking money supply to a lower level. Okay, these things are repetitions as you can see. We have done it 2 times already. So higher repo rate or bank rate becomes a contractionary monetary policy. Okay, which you might have read in newspapers many a times by now. Okay, in last few months, RBI has increased repo rate.